Ed vlastně vystudoval mezinárodní rozvoj a mezinárodní vztahy na univerzitě v Leedsu a v současné době se v organizaci Feedback zabývá hlavně tím, že tedy vede výzkum v oblasti plýtvání potravinami. A tomu se věnuje hlavně na mezinárodním dodavatelském poli, a to především plýtvání jídla při produkci zeleniny na export z Afriky a Latinské Ameriky. A já mu tedy předávám slovo a ještě jednou upozorním, že to bude v angličtině, takže kdo si není v angličtině jist, tak má ještě poslední šanci se přesunout za naší překladatelkou, za teď na nás mává Sabinu Polákovou.
Thank you very much. My name's Ed and I represent an organisation called Feedback. I think the translation of my biography got a little bit confused, which says at the end I like diving and climbing. I actually like bin diving, which is a practice some of you may have heard of, going to the back of supermarket bins, taking out waste food and using that food. I don't know if there's a Czech word for bin diving, probably not, but that's how I got involved in food waste. I started finding lots of food waste in bins, taking that home, cooking up big meals for my friends, and went on to end up setting up a cafe using that food. So that's why food waste is of interest to me, and hopefully I'll be able to convince you if you're not already interested in food waste. So today I'm going to talk about how unfair trading practices relate to food waste, and also how food waste can be a good tool to campaign on this issue, which is really topical at the moment. So Feedback began in 2009, and the guy called Tristram Stewart founded Feedback. We host big public feasts. Some of you may have been to the one in Prague 2 weeks ago, which sounds like it was really successful. We collect food that would have gone to waste from lots of different sources. We hold big free events. Everyone can come along and eat and learn about the issues of food waste, and then also platforms to challenge governments, challenge supermarkets to reduce waste. So whenever we're doing these big events, we talk about this huge scale, the global scale of waste, and we've been doing research for years now. Just to give you some examples, these are some tomatoes grown in Spain. As you may have guessed, they've all gone to waste. Does anyone know why they've been wasted? Yeah, so colour, size, and maybe shape as well. They might not be the right, they might not be perfectly round. Once again, oranges in Tenerife, huge amounts going to waste, and bananas in Ecuador, all because of the cosmetic specifications. There are governmental standards of what should be allowed to the market, but they're very relaxed. And what we find is private supermarkets have really strong cosmetic standards, and they only allow to the millimeter exact size, shape, and color specifications. Which means that when there's not a strong secondary market, when the food can't be sold locally or to industrial processes, all of this produce is wasted, which means that farmers aren't paid for the produce they grow, and that doesn't cover the costs of all the water, land, labour, agrochemicals that went into growing that food. So when we think about food waste, we need to actually think about all those wasted resources. That, for me, is the bigger issue. It's not about what food we throw in the bin, it's about all the inputs and all the resources going into food. So here we can see the end result of that. When the waste isn't managed properly, you have the adverse effects of methane production as well, leading to global warming. And recently, a statistic came out that if food waste was a country, it would be the third largest emitter of carbon emissions globally. So you can see the scale of the impacts post-waste actually happening. We work up the supply chain, so we go from farms to manufacturers. In this example, you can see the ends of bread being thrown away by a sandwich producer. Has anyone ever seen a sandwich in a shop using the end of a loaf of bread? No? This is where they end up. We use this information to campaign on a supermarket in the UK. They now make sure that all that bread is processed into other products or goes into feeding animals instead of just being wasted in a big dump like this. And we also campaign, like I said, on waste coming from supermarkets. So there's been a lot of pressure around Europe to get supermarkets to donate more food to food banks or just to try and sell it better. Here you can see perfectly good food. This is the kind of food that I would eat when I was taking food from bins. It's all delicious. A lot of the time you're getting some organic produce that you might not be able to afford otherwise, because it all gets thrown away regardless of quality. But today I'm going to talk about Kenya. So my research is focused on export supply chains, predominantly in the global south. We've been to Kenya, Guatemala, and I've just come back from Costa Rica looking at waste that's caused in these markets by supermarkets and their importers. We've come up with a definition of what food waste is. There is two terms, food waste and food losses. Food waste, the most important thing here is that it's about actions and decisions. Food is wasted. People choose to waste food because it's the wrong shape or size. They choose to throw away perfectly good food. It's not that this food rots, it's not that it's damaged or that it's fallen on the floor. Whereas when food is lost, it might be because of poor storage methods, it might be that food is lost by falling inside a truck. This is really important because if someone's deciding that food can be wasted, that can be changed. You can change that behaviour pattern very simply. And we can reduce the impact of food waste. So in Kenya, up to 50% of food that is grown for European markets is wasted. And as you can see here, it's predominantly because the products don't look perfect. They don't fit into perfect man-made plastic packaging. This means that the farmers only get paid for the produce that they can export. And the exporters then in turn only get paid for what they can export as well. So there's this huge economic loss for farmers. This isn't just happening in the countries I've mentioned, it's happening everywhere, including the UK, including the Czech Republic as well. There's huge amounts of food going to waste, and people don't get paid, which is putting the pressure on producers to supply even cheaper food for even less money. An additional thing we found in Kenya was a practice called topping and tailing. This is mainly in products like French beans, where the top and the bottom of the bean have been cut. And it's a normal practice to chop a bean, maybe taking the end off when you're cooking. But in this practice, you can see that it's the flattest part of the bean, and up to 30 to 40% of the bean is wasted through this practice. So already 50% has been thrown away in the farm. Another 30 to 40% is chopped off and thrown away in the pack house. And then after all of that, there's a third level of waste. The order can be cancelled, as we've heard earlier, at the last minute. Meaning that even though all of these processes have been paid for, all this food has been prepared to be perfect, at the last minute it can just be thrown away. So this is all negative news. Food waste, all bad things I'm telling you, but there are some solutions. So we went to Tesco's in the UK and told them about this practice of topping and tailing of beans. And we asked them to change this practice to buy whole beans instead. They didn't go the full length. You can see that they're still chopping one part of the bean. And whilst this may seem like a very small difference, it's actually huge. When you calculate how much is being wasted in every export house, to then be able to only chop one end rather than both has meant that some exporters are saving €70,000 a year, have reduced their waste by a third, and are offering better prices to farmers and better prices to supermarkets, meaning that everyone has won. And even consumers are winning. If you think, when you cut both ends of the bean, the shelf life of the product is dramatically reduced. So if you were to buy a packet like this in the supermarket now, it's going to last for a lot longer. You're going to be able to enjoy the food for a bit longer rather than just wasting it in your home. So, as I said, it seems like a very small percentage, but when you stack that up and you see these vast quantities of boxes piling up in export houses, it's huge. We calculate that it's roughly 0.4% of Kenya's GDP that can be saved just through this one single practice, which shows that if you're addressing food waste rather than losses, you can have huge impacts on economy and on environmental standards. So, I mentioned just now about order cancellations. These are some of the overarching results from our research. And I'd like to make a link between cosmetic specifications and order cancellations. So when cosmetic specifications are used, they're generally seen to be quality standard that produce below a certain spec cannot be sold. But we find during different parts of the year, these specifications go up and go down. So when there's a global oversupply of food, the cosmetic specifications get stronger and more orders get cancelled at the last minute. But instead of being cancelled, which is now illegal in the UK, the supermarkets and their importers will use cosmetic specifications as a cover-up. What I mean by that is an exporter will have to supply, for example, 10 tons a week in advance. When it gets to the final date, the producer will either cancel the order or will accept the food and allow it to arrive in, say, the UK. 3 to 5 days later, that same importer will cancel that order by saying the quality wasn't good enough. And if you see people in Kenya, they need to make sure the quality is perfect before it's sent to the UK. Every last thing is exactly the right shape and size, the right colour. Everything is perfect. And so these quality measures are used to cover up the practice, which is now illegal, this unfair trading practice of order cancellations. And there's additional impacts to farmers. If you take the issue of pesticide levels, farmers are told that their produce is being rejected because pesticides have been too high in their products. So the farmer has to then panic about the rest of his crop. Does that mean that his whole crop has got too many pesticides on it? Should he destroy his whole crop? Or should he risk trying to sell that same crop the next day to the same exporter? And what we found in our research is that a lot of the time, that farmer can deliver the same product the next day and all the food be accepted, no problems whatsoever. In the UK, we found examples of potato farmers turning up to a supermarket to deliver a set quantity of paper potatoes for it to be cancelled and rejected on the spot. The farmer had to pay for all those costs. He turned around, went back to his farm, and the next day drove back with the same lorry, with the same potatoes, the same volume, and sold absolutely everything. So you can see that these cosmetic specifications are varied and used as a way to determine how much the supermarket actually has to buy. Here you can see once again just the sheer quantity of all this food. We used examples of this food in Kenya to serve the United Nations at an environmental dinner party to try and kickstart a conversation about how to redistribute food in the country. And people are beginning to now think about how we can use this food to feed people in a country where millions of people go to bed hungry every night. But we shouldn't really be focusing on that, redistributing this waste, because the fundamental issue here is overproduction. These farmers are overproducing 150 to 200% of their crop. That's produce that they know they will never sell, and costs that they know they will never be reimbursed for. So rather than trying to redistribute this at a lower price, or indeed additional costs, we should be trying to change the cosmetic specifications and these market fluctuations. Because ultimately, what we're looking at is more and more resources being used for food that's never consumed. That's the real problem. Not food wastage, but overproduction. So I was talking about the social impact. When we hear about food waste, we generally focus on environmental impacts and sometimes economic impacts. But there's also a social side to this. When a farmer's not paid, they generally have to take out a loan to cover their costs, including labour. This means they go into a cycle of debt, and some farmers, particularly this guy on the right here, means that he doesn't have enough money to pay for his kids to go to school and put food on his own table. Despite being surrounded by an abundance of food, these farmers aren't able to then feed themselves. So we're now trying to campaign and promote this issue because people aren't thinking about the real impacts this is having on farmers. Farmers are now going out of business. I think we heard earlier about producers, all kinds of suppliers, not just farmers, being pushed out of the market because of increased costs and more risk in the market. And this is a really clear example of that happening again. Once again, quite a nice picture, I think. You can see beans come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. I did eat all of those while I was out there. I'm sure all of you would eat them as well. So I hope you join us in demanding this from supermarkets around the world to make sure that this product is used for what it's intended for. None of this food is consumed in Kenya. It's seen as what's called a Mzungu food, which means European food. Kenyans do not generally eat French beans, do not generally eat mange tout or sugar snap beans. It's all exported, it's seen basically as money from one plant that it's there to be harvested and sent straight away. I sat with a farmer for lunch one day and he didn't touch any vegetables. It wasn't in his cultural interest, he didn't recognise it as food. He actually thought I was weird for asking for this kind of food. So they're not able to sell this locally. It does all get wasted. And we need to appreciate that, because these people have been not being paid as much as they would in Europe for this, and we're increasingly putting them under a lot of pressure to produce the same food that we then end up wasting. So earlier we heard about unfair trading practices, and indeed that's why a lot of you are here. Currently Europe is looking at how to implement legislation or a directive on unfair trading practices, which will protect producers from these abusive practices from supermarkets. In the UK, we're very lucky. We have a system called, a law called the Groceries Supply Code of Practice, and it's regulated by somebody called the Groceries Code Adjudicator. Some of you may have heard of that already, but essentially what that person does is they're a watchdog. They are there to receive complaints anonymously from suppliers of unfair practices, and they can then investigate supermarkets for breaches of this law. Recently, they've been given the power to fine supermarkets up to 1% of their turnover, which in the case of someone like Tesco's is £400 million. It's a lot of money if they're to be found breaking order cancellations, delaying payments, or any of the other issues we heard about earlier from the other research, including forced marketing costs. The problem with this system in the UK is that so many producers are so fearful of their business. They live within a climate of fear. And so even though there is an anonymous system guaranteed to them, they're scared to come through. So there's been some surveys done, and still we're finding the suppliers facing these unfair trading practices, but no one wants to talk out, even though in the UK we have this amazing law set up. I understand in the Czech Republic there's a similar law being discussed at the moment, but without an adjudicator. So to give you a bit of a background on why we have that role, in 2001 the code was set up, and it was set up basically to define a law, what is unfair trading practices, and once it's defined, we can just make it stop happening. What we found was that still unfair trading practices happened, and in some places it increased. So the Competition Commission in the UK said that this can't be a voluntary system, we can't just have a set of laws, we need someone to actually go out and investigate this, and to adjudicate and regulate the system, which led to the Groceries Code Adjudicator being appointed in 2013. And I hope similar laws can begin to be implemented around Europe, including the Czech Republic. So the four areas that we're now campaigning on for this practice to be spread across Europe include for people to be able to launch investigations. This is the most important thing, that they need to be anonymous. As I say, there's this fear factor. Suppliers basically just accept these problems as business as usual. They are under increasingly high pressure for lower costs, higher costs, lower prices, they're forced to waste food, and they can't do anything about it. But rather than risk losing business, they'd rather just stay quiet. So if any of these laws can be set up properly in any country around Europe, they have to have an anonymous platform where someone is able to actually go out and investigate on behalf of the supplier. To give an example of how that works in the UK, the Groceries Code Adjudicator could be approached by a carrot farmer, and the carrot farmer could say, I've had all my orders cancelled for the last month, I've had all these extra practices put on me which are unfair, here's the evidence. The adjudicator will then go to that supermarket and won't investigate carrots, won't investigate vegetables, but will investigate the whole fresh produce sector. So there's no way that supermarket has any idea who issued the original complaint. And that's key to finding any evidence and to actually penalise these companies. The second area is that we need to make sure that we include the whole supply chain. So in the UK at the moment, the Groceries Code Adjudicator is set up to only regulate the relationship between the supermarket and the direct supplier. That means the examples of Kenyan farmers are not covered by this law. So the people, the weakest actors in the supply chain, some of the smallest producers, and indeed some of the biggest producers, are not protected because they're not directly supplying. But what we find is that although supermarkets have a really strong concentration of power in the centre of the system, there are concentric rings around that. So manufacturers or importers, the direct suppliers, also have a degree of power and are able to transfer their risk down the supply chain. So if an order is cancelled, a supermarket order that cancels an order with an importer, they then have the power to cancel their order with the exporter. In the case of Kenya, producing baby vegetables and other fresh produce, they're competing globally with Morocco, Egypt, Senegal, and Guatemala. So these importers will be able to buy from lots of different countries, or order from lots of countries, and at the last minute, cancel or reduce their volumes dependent on price, dependent on demand from the supermarket, and the supermarket's protected because they haven't made the final order cancellation. So we need to make sure that all these people are included in that system. The third is that we need to have financial sanctions. This is really important because if we just simply tell the supermarket off, there's always a way of spinning that into a positive story. You know, the supermarket didn't know it was happening, for example, where they're now going to try really hard to improve. If we don't have financial sanctions, we can't really be threatening enough to tell supermarkets that this is unacceptable and that it's damaging to businesses. This is now being championed by a lot of fair trade movement with the European parliamentary process at the moment. But what feedback in particular are pushing for is for any income from these sanctions to be ring-fenced and used to compensate producers who have come forward. So if you've not been able to sell your produce and you've lost money from that, then we believe that the money penalised at the supermarket should be used to cover your costs again. The fourth and final area is that we believe we need to coordinate across the whole of Europe. And the practices that we're hearing about in the Czech Republic, the practices that have been going on for years in the UK and indeed the whole of Europe, and increasingly across the world. In order for us to actually make sure that we stop these practices properly, we need to make sure that we're speaking amongst European countries and that enforcement bodies are able to communicate evidence and details about these practices. An example I could give would be a UK supermarket no longer practicing any unfair trading practices and instead going to a French importer and buying all their food from France, and the French importer then committing all these practices. Unless we stop this from happening, ultimately that system's going to be flawed. So, as I say, we're now working with groups like Fair Trade Advocacy Office and other people within the Fair Trade movement to campaign on this issue. And we want European MEPs to be championing the four main principles that we're putting forward. If we're able to address unfair trading practices, we'll be able to address the issue of food waste and all the issues surrounding overproduction. We currently are set for a huge global population increase by 2050, and people are predicting that we need to, in some cases, double food production to meet the demands of a meat-hungry, energy-hungry population. Feedback fundamentally believes if we address the issue of food waste, then actually we'd be able to free up enough food for billions more people. If we couple that with addressing meat consumption as well, even more food could be made available. And the easiest way to do that is to address these practices. If supermarkets can relax their cosmetic standards and accept more fruit and vegetables, producers won't have to produce so much food in the first place. They won't have as many costs. They won't need as much land and resources. If there's less fluctuation in the market, similarly the same things will happen as well. So we need to address both those problems, not just for the sake of farmers, not just for the sake of consumers, but more generally for global food security. So it is a really serious issue. That's the last slide. Yes, so to recap, just there's two single things we can change. Changing supermarket policies will have huge ramifications, and the more I hear about it in the Czech Republic, it becomes more pressing that we need to have similar initiatives going on in every country. I've just come back from Costa Rica and found that Latin American supermarkets are now using the same practices against producers in Latin America. And what we see is that more Western supermarkets are being implemented around the world as the main model of food consumption and sales, the same practices time and time again are being translated into other countries. And each time they're going somewhere new, people aren't prepared for them. People don't use these economic models because they are intrinsically unfair. We don't learn about these models. And so when people buy into the supermarket system, they are forced, they're obligated to comply, possibly leading to unfair practice. So I hope that was clear, the connections there. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer those as well.